Well, they call them the cardiac cues for a reason. 1 week ago today, Syracuse men's basketball got its biggest victory of the year over number 7 North Carolina. On Saturday, arguably the worst loss of the season on the road against one of the bottom dwellers of the ACC in Georgia Tech. Tonight, against a very good NC State team, the Orange come out on top. 87-83 in a nail biter. A first half that was dominated by the Cuse. A second half where they almost lost it, but that's just the cardiac cues. That's what they're going to do. We'll break it all down here on Orange Press Pass. Our Phil Galati will join us live from Raleigh. You don't want to go anywhere. Orange Press Pass starts right now. Hello, everyone, and welcome into our Citrus TV studios for today's episode of Orange Press Pass. I'm Adam Gotkin. That's Skylar Wilkes. That's Luke Burgess. Now, guys, what a game this was today. Just the epitome of this Syracuse season. Skylar, I want to start with you. Your first thoughts on the game.
What happened, Adam? That's my first thought. Simple as that. Syracuse seemed like it had it all locked away. The win was in easy. It was right there for the taking, but then a second half collapse, and NC State comes all the way back, took the lead at one point in the second half. That has been all too common for Syracuse this season.
Yeah, Adam, you kind of took the words right out of my mouth, honestly, because I'm just not surprised at the ways that this game has gone. You look back at that UNC win that you mentioned a moment ago. You also look at that Louisville win, where it was essentially just a shootout down the line. Syracuse has not done a good job of keeping in these games and really, I guess, playing with the lead in an efficient way. And that was kind of the theme again tonight. They blow what was really a phenomenal first half.
Well, we've told you guys the themes and the overarching storylines, but why wait any longer? Let's get straight into today's highlights. The Orange have struggled mightily in the state of North Carolina this season. 0-3 with three blowout losses to Duke, North Carolina, and Wake Forest. But get it going early with Chris Bell in the corner, and you'll see this as a trend. 24 points in the first half for the sophomore, and he has said all year long that it's all about confidence. He had that mojo today. Knocks down another one there. First 6 points, and hey, I mean, why not another? First 9 points of the game, Chris Bell on fire early. He had 8 3-pointers in the first half alone, but hey, NC State wasn't going to go down easy. DJ Horn, he made that three. He went 3 for 3 from deep in the first half and had 21 points. Everyone was going off in this game, especially this guy, Quadier Copeland, efficient as ever. 5 for 5 from the field in the first half, and he made it done fancy, but, you know, he got it in the hoop at the end of the day. That's what's important. And J.J. Starling, he's been exceptional ever since that first NC State game, knocks down the mid-range jumper there. But the Wolfpack out of the half started off strong. That's Muhammad Diarra with the slam and one. And then you see here, Ben Middlebrooks gets the offensive rebound and the putback. He was kind of the silent assassin in this game. 10 rebounds, 6 of them on the offensive end. DJ Burns, haven't heard much of him. He's known for his scoring, also can feed like that, great assists. And now here we see the scoring. He has over 50 pounds on Malik Brown, turns around, puts it in, and Judah Mintz, we haven't even said his name yet. Here he is right now. No points in the first half, 15 in the second, a huge part in the Cuse's victory, and Quadier Copeland puts the icing on the cake. 2 free throws at the end. The Orange come out victorious. 25 points for Quadier, a career high. Syracuse wins it 87-83. I mean, if you told me coming into this game that Quadier Copeland and Chris Bell would be the two Syracuse players on that list, no Judah, no JJ, I'd tell you you're crazy.
Hope Ithaca was treating you well. You don't look too shabby considering the conditions over there, but I wanted to ask about the end of the game and the tension between, you know, all sides. I mean, the fans, both of the teams. What was the energy like in that building?
I mean, it was an energy unlike anything that I've really ever been in because, of course, this wasn't just a great game. This wasn't just a double overtime game, but it was one between two teams that know each other very, very well, just about an hour apart. I mean, we'll probably see you guys before the night is over. And there's also some connections between this team. CJ Kirst just came by us about 10 minutes ago and asked if we knew his brother, Cole Kirst, who played for Syracuse a couple years ago. CJ really, you know, followed that team when his brother was with them. So he knew those guys, and this game meant a lot to him, and there were a lot of Syracuse fans here, and you just said the weather, it wasn't great. So everything just kind of piled on top of itself until it turned into pure chaos, and that's what overtime was. The ball was going back and forth, turnover after turnover, and the energy was just unlike anything else. It was really something special. You know, I think maybe this home crowd helped out Cornell a little bit at the end, because there were some more Cornell fans here. There was the Cornell women's team that was here after they played Syracuse earlier in the day, but really, it was just an awesome energy, and I do think it helped Cornell a little bit at the very end.
Hey, Adam. Adam here. My question really has to relate to the discipline of this Syracuse team, and did they sort of lose their discipline throughout the game, or was this just more Cornell waking up in that second half?
Yeah, I don't know, and I think that's a really hard question to answer, because Syracuse has been in situations like this before this year. You think back to the Maryland game, to the Army game. The Orange are not new to being in late-game situations, and because of that, I think that I give a lot of this credit to this Cornell team. When we talked to C.J. Kearse, when we talked to Connor Busek, the head coach of Cornell, they were just saying how the grit is really something that is installed into these players from day one inside the program. When they step on campus here in Ithaca, it's all about being gritty. It's all about being guys who are going to be able to perform in situations like this, going to be able to come back after starting the game down 7-0, and that's what these guys showed today. This is a smart team. It's a team that never let that deficit get to its head, and because of that, I think you really give the credit to Cornell. Syracuse has to be better. I mean, you can't not say that, because you can't give up a 7-0 lead and then end up losing. But again, at the end of the day, I think that you just give the credit to Cornell for coming back. This is a Cornell team that has also been in situations like this, has lost games in overtime, and has also won games in overtime. So I think it's a little bit 50-50, but I don't think you can go all in on the saying that this is all Syracuse being bad.
When you lose Levante Johnson, when you lose Nate Opoku, the question was always going to be coming into this season, where are the goals going to come from? At the start, there was no answer. But as the season's gone on, that answer has developed into Nick Kaloukian. 3 goals over the last 5 matches, and this is a guy that's done it at every level. At Michigan, he led the Wolverines in goals with 4. He was named to the All-Big Ten freshman team, and as Kaloukian continues to get better as the year goes on, this Orange offense will just get better and better.
Syracuse and Maryland played a game for the ages. The Terps won 13-12 in overtime, but tomorrow, no one's going to be talking about the final score. All of the national conversation will revolve around the controversial call towards the end. With just over a minute to go in overtime, Michael Leo dashed down GLE, dove towards the crease, and put the ball into the back of the net. Now, the referees say he landed in the goal mouth. Gary Gates says he was pushed. It's a controversial play that'll be looked at not just tomorrow, not just this week, but into June when the NCAA Rules Committee meets. I don't know if there's a word in the English dictionary that can describe what went down tonight, because crazy isn't good enough. Bonkers, insane, none of those can describe the match between Syracuse and Penn State. 88 minutes in, the score was 0-0. 13 seconds later, it was 1-1, and that's how the match ended. Tonight's game was one of the greatest games that you'll ever see in college soccer, and even though the Orange couldn't come out with the win, head coach Ian McIntyre was very happy with how his team performed today. When most people think of a lacrosse field, they imagine something like this, a large open space larger than a football field, 110 yards by 60, but in reality, there's an entire other subsection of the sport called box lacrosse, played at places like this, Burnett Park on the west side of Syracuse. No, your eyes don't deceive you. Those are hockey boards all the way around. They put turf on top, and the impact that that box game plays on the field game is undeniable.
Kids should play box first, is the ball really never goes out of bounds. So that young kids playing, they go out and play the field game, they maybe a bad pass or the ball goes out of bounds, you got to chase the ball for, you know, a couple hundred yards, go get the ball and bring it back. The box is always in play, and you can just get a lot more touches, a lot more repetition in the box game.
4 Orange players spent this past summer playing in the Ontario Junior Lacrosse League, the top amateur competition in the world.
I see huge benefits in playing in the box game. You know, you don't have as much time and space, so you're, you know, it's a little bit more confined, and so you know, the decision making is a lot quicker, and you know, it's a little more physical just because there's not as much time and space. So, you know, obviously on a field or in a box, there's not as much room to get away from your defender and stuff.
You know, even just cutting through the crease, you know, not really tightening up, you know, kind of being able to just cut through and, you know, play and, you know, take checks and just, you know, kind of just keep on playing.
I think that just, you know, we had an offense where we can just go out there and have fun. And that's something that, you know, it's just playing backyard lacrosse, something that I love to do. So I think, like, just looking at it at that perspective that, you know, we're just going to go out there, have some fun, and let the plays come to us.
The effect of playing a summer in Canada for Orange attackmen Joey Spallina and Trey Deer extended off the field as well.
I mean, I pretty much lived with Trey the whole summer, so, you know, obviously you guys can see how that went. But it was good. I mean, we had a great time. And
this summer we kind of spent almost every day together. We lived at two separate houses, but there was a group, there were six of us, and we were either at the place I was staying at or Joey's house, and we basically did everything together. Whether it was golfing, going to shoot, like whatever it may be, we did it as a group. So it kind of made we kind of built like a mini family, and so it was good to get to know them, especially before coming playing here.
This past summer is already paying off for Spallina. He leads the nation in points. Adam Gotkin, Citrus TV.
The Central New York sports leader, Z89.
Z89 Studios. I'm Adam Gotkin, taking you up until midnight Eastern time on this wonderful Wednesday in Central New York. We've got about an hour and 15 minutes in show left. Before I get to my men's bracket, I'll give every single pick, round of 64, all the way until the national championship. We'll talk some Syracuse women's basketball, still a little bit away until the Cuse get on the court, opening up the tournament on Saturday down in Storrs, Connecticut. Syracuse gets a 6 seed. We'll take on the winner of a play-in game. Tomorrow night at 7 p.m., Arizona takes on Auburn, 2 11 seeds. The winner taking on Syracuse on Saturday at 3:30 p.m. We'll have the coverage here on your Central New York sports leader, Z89. Orange women's warm-up will start at 3 p.m. for that. Ethan Frank and Ben Spector will be live in Storrs, so you want to tune in for that for sure. But let's talk about this Syracuse women's team and the expectations and what they should be and how I think this team will do in the tournament. It's hard to predict right now because, you know, we're talking about a team that doesn't even know its first-round opponent, and it's difficult to play the play-in winner. You're playing a team that's already won a tournament game. You're playing a team that played just a couple days ago. Syracuse hasn't played in a long time. The ACC Women's Basketball Tournament is the week before the men's tournament, which means that the last time Syracuse played was March 8th. It will be over 2 weeks between Syracuse's last game and the next one. And if you're an SU fan, that might be a good thing. Because my goodness, what an awful performance for the Orange in the ACC tournament. Losing 78-65 in the quarterfinal, SU got a bye to the quarter. So in the first and only game, lose by 13, and it was a lot worse than that. SU got trounced. I mean, the Orange were down almost 30 at points in that game before kind of coming back and winning the fourth quarter by 9 points, but things looked bad. Things looked really, really bad. So, SU fans, Central New York, should you be concerned? Overarching themes around this Syracuse team, does it have what it takes to make a deep run? I don't know. I really don't know, and I really don't think so, to be honest. I don't think that this team has what it takes to make a deep run. I think there's no chance they'd beat UConn in the second round. And as time goes on, as I think more and more back on this season, and as I think more and more on the style of play of this Syracuse team, on the roster buildup, I just don't think that this is a team that's built to win any game in tournament play.